Hello and welcome. This is another episode of Make It Happen, a podcast by Wahido Marata. Today's guest, believe it or not, is Evan Carmichael. He runs the biggest YouTube channel for entrepreneurs with 1.5 million subscribers and growing. He aims to help 1 billion entrepreneurs, and he's a fantastic guy based in Canada, and I cannot wait to have you listen to what he has to say. Welcome to Make It Happen. I'm Wahido Marata, a certified life coach committed to helping entrepreneurs excel in life through mindset acceleration. In each episode, we'll explore a topic related to mindset and share tips and tools that can help you rebrand, revive, and realize your fullest potential. Thank you for listening and enjoy the show.
Here we are. I love it. This is it. It's happening. It is happening. Wahido in the house.
Well, this is a pleasure. Of course, you know that, but thank you so much for taking your time and for being here. I mean, how amazing, how crazy it is to finally, you know, be face to face with you in this way. I mean, it's very, very good. And thank you very much.
I'm pumped, man. Let's make it happen. I'm ready. Yeah. Anything you want to cover, let's go.
Well, I have so much to cover. And, you know, I would like to, you know, it would be a pleasure to actually know more about yourself and a bit about your path. You know, I've saw many videos and I've seen many interviews, but, you know, I would like my listeners and my audience to actually know who's behind this amazing person that I've been speaking about for so long, who has, you know, has done so many things that, you know, many people don't even dream of doing or being able to or believe that it's possible. So perhaps a little bit about your background and where you grew up, where you come from, and how did you actually become the person that you are at the moment?
Sure. So I'll go quick. And if there's something you want to dive deeper in, let me know. I'm Canadian, born and raised in Toronto, Canada. I had a lot of entrepreneurial tendencies growing up, but I didn't actually start a business till I was 19 and like an official business, I guess. I sucked and struggled and felt worthless, making $300 a month, getting my business off the ground. Among the most embarrassing and you know, full of shame days of my life that I wanted to eventually get through. I found my way through. We had some success. I was one of the entrepreneurs who made it, I guess, or most people don't. And I'm a big believer that your purpose comes from your pain. So it became a big part of my mission to give back to entrepreneurs and help the next generation people coming through. As a result, I did a lot of speaking internationally. I have a website, I have a YouTube channel where I help entrepreneurs. I have two books, and I'm fighting every day to try to solve the world's biggest problem, untapped human potential. I think most people are just doing the wrong thing. I think everybody has the ability to do something amazing. I don't think someone like you know, Will Smith is that extraordinary. I think everybody has that ability. I think everybody could be a Michael Jordan at something. They just either one haven't found it, or they two don't believe in their abilities to make it happen. So that's what I'm trying to accomplish.
So what were the biggest challenges and struggles that you found when it somehow clicked to you that you wanted to be an entrepreneur?
The biggest one that motivated me a lot was regret. Growing up, I thought I wanted to be a banker. My high school yearbook says, where are you going to be in 10 years of graduating? I said banker. VP at some bank. And so that was a path I thought. Now, growing up for me as well, entrepreneurship wasn't, I had no family who were in entrepreneurship. It wasn't a popular thing to be an entrepreneur. So it wasn't on my radar screen. And when I had the opportunity in university to start a company, the decision that I made it through was just regret. I had these opportunities to work at some big companies, earning, you know, 100K a year out of the gate, traveling around the world, like my dream job, or start a business and make $300 a month. Why go do the entrepreneurial path? It was just out of fear of regret. I felt like I could come back and do another job if I really wanted to, but I may not ever get the chance again to start this business. And I could deal with it failing, which would be the likely scenario because most businesses fail. I could deal with it failing and not working out. I couldn't deal with not knowing. So I used that fear of regret to push me to do the thing that I was afraid to do.
And, you know, I love your hashtag, you know, believe. And I'm a true believer on belief, you know, and, you know, my work is always, you know, trying to find where, what's the limiting belief system and become a belief system that is actually empowering. So what is belief for you, and why do you actually chose, you know, from billions of hashtags, that hashtag for your work?
Yeah, so I'm a big believer that everybody has a one word core value. At the core of you, there's one most important value that you have. I wrote a book about it, but mine is believe. It comes from my parents. They're actually on my wall behind me. That's me when I'm 9 years old and my parents. And they would always tell me that I was Evan Pistrilli Carmichael. I could do anything that I believe that I can do. And that had a profound impact on me. And belief for me is yes, is self-confidence and believe in yourself. I think that's what most people think about when they think about belief. But it's also believe in the work that you're doing, like follow your passion, do the work that is meaningful, believe in your work. And then also just believe in that it's going to work out, believe in the impact that you can have. And so I run everything through that lens. That's the best of who I am. And I try to bring that to everything that I make. This interview, I hope, oozes belief. Every video that I make, every book that I write, every conversation I have, I want people walking away from feeling a little bit more belief in themselves.
And do you think this is something that people gain through life, or somehow it clicks, you know, now I believe, or is it something that you need to be born with?
So for those like nature nurture questions, I'm not a huge fan of them, because like, it's so what? So if you weren't born with a lot of XYZ, what, do you stop? Like if you want to go off and do something, then go and do it. You can. I think for most of the major changes that anybody wants to make in their life or in their business, it almost always starts with a mindset shift, with changing a belief system that you have, of turning something from saying I could never do this to actually thinking, oh, I can. And so for me, what I found super helpful is I need to fill myself up with belief on a daily basis. I think it's a daily reset. Like even if you had the greatest day, the next day you wake up, at least for me, and I don't wake up every day like, yes, Thursday, right? I'm tired and I wake up and I'm wiping my eyes and it's like, what's happening today? And it's a daily reset. So I think having a routine that sets you up, the goal would be to fill yourself up with so much of your one word. So for me, it's believe, that if I'm ever around anybody who doesn't believe or is negative or toxic or putting out just really crappy energy, I'm not going to get infected. I'm drinking so much vitamin C that you can sneeze all over me and I'm not going to get sick. And I think people don't have enough of the positive in their environment, and then they get sneezed on by somebody and then they get sick, and they allow the toxicity of the people around them to pull them down instead of allowing them to go off and do the thing that they want to do.
Totally. I totally agree with that. And so from an entrepreneurial sort of perspective, do you believe it's important for a brand, for instance, to have a hashtag and follow that hashtag wherever they go?
I think it helps. I think articulating the brand makes it easier for people to spread the message. I think when people understand what you stand for, it one, makes it easier for them to align themselves with you or not, and easier to share your message. I think you look at most corporations and everybody has a list of core values. You got a list of your 15 core values and they have them up on a wall. But, you know, go and ask the CEO even of that company, can you tell me what those 15 core values are? Most of them couldn't do it without looking it up. So you're not actually living it, let alone everybody else in the organization. And so I think having one that is the through line, that this is what I stand for, this is what I'm all about, helps you first in terms of guiding your creation, guiding the content, guiding your products, guiding your services, guiding everything that you make. I run it through the filter of belief. So if I'm making a top 10 video on somebody, it's only gonna show the positive. If this video does not help somebody believe, then I'm not gonna publish it. I'm not gonna make a video of the top 10 stupidest things Donald Trump has ever said. That video might explode and do really well, but I'm not posting it because it's not believed. And so when you have your value down, it becomes a through line for everything that you do, and it makes it easy for other people to align themselves with you. So people who need more belief in their life, it's easy for them to subscribe to me. They love it. They just wake up and boom, there's more content, easy, boom, right? Whether it's Instagram or YouTube or somewhere else, So making it clear is good for you, but it's also good for your audience to find you and for them to share it as well. So anytime their friends need to believe, they will automatically think of what I'm doing. So whether you are, you know, articulating it as clearly in that hashtag in every single post that you're doing or not, I think having a clear through line first for yourself and then making it easy for your audience to share it, I think becomes super important.
You know, I work a lot with mindset, and you know, it's fascinating for me always to look at entrepreneurs like you try to kind of put myself in your place and put myself in your mindset and try to sort of apply or find out what I could use from that mindset in my life. So could you share, for instance, your mindset or perhaps your routines or daily routines that you believe it's vital for any entrepreneur to actually apply in their lives?
So the first mindset shift is just one of resourcefulness. I think a lot of people say, well, how am I ever gonna do this? You can ask the same question with the same words, but change the mindset behind it. Instead of, well, how am I ever gonna do this, is how am I ever gonna do this? Where there's the belief, there's the resourcefulness in there. How am I ever gonna launch this company without funding? How am I gonna launch this company without funding? Just shifting that instead of focusing on what you don't have, because you never have enough. I could use 20 more people in my company, sure. If you gave me $1 million to do something else, I could find a way to use that. But instead of focusing on what you don't have, focus on what you can do with what you do have. There are people who have done exactly what you want to do with less than what you already have right now. And so if they can do it, you don't have an excuse why you can't do it too. And so just shifting the conversation on resourcefulness in the questions that you are having. The other one I would say, a mindset shift that I have, was shifting your self-respect towards effort instead of results. So a lot of people are so afraid to fail that they never even try because they're attaching their self-respect to winning. Really loose and dangerous spot. If you're in a race, you're running a race and you beat a five-year-old child, you're not going to feel that great about yourself. Sure, you won, but it's an easy win. Where if you lose a race against somebody like Usain Bolt, the fact that you even ran that race against Usain Bolt should be building up your self-respect. And so if you can tie your self-respect to the effort that you put in, like if you may not win every time, and you won't win every time, and you'll lose most of the time in anything that you're doing. If you're on the edge, if you're doing something new, if you're an entrepreneur, you will lose most of the time because you're trying something new. So that's part of the game. But if you are on the edge of you pushing your boundaries of your effort, like when you hit the bed tonight, you put your face on the pillows, like I gave myself today, like I tried my hardest today. And to shift your self-respect around that, as that's the gut check every night. Did I do my best that I could today? That'll make you feel good. If you did that every day, I guarantee you will start getting wins. But if you attach your self-respect to winning, then you will never get those wins because you're so afraid of the losses. And so I think that's been a really helpful mindset shift for me. And then if I had to pick a third one, I would just say, embracing the complicated, embracing the complexity, embracing, like, when it sucks, it's the best. When something's going wrong, it's awesome. Like, you grow through adversity, right? For everybody who's complaining about their environment or their parents or their XYZ, like, that's the best. When it's easy, it's easy. But when it's hard, that's when you grow. That's when you get stronger. And so I've shifted myself that anytime something negative happens, it's the best. Like if this call, we lose my video and it's only audio, this is the best. Like I'll get even more excited than I am right now, right? When something bad happens, I just shift to that automatically. I tell myself it's the best and then I feel that it's the best and it actually becomes the best.
Yeah, and for me, you know, when people are able to go through their fears and actually focus on the process rather than the outcome, then life can become actually magical. And then, you know, the fear doesn't stop you to go further and to actually learn the lessons, you know, because to go a little bit in what you're saying, for me, there's no failures because there's always a lesson. And if there is a lesson, the failures, perceived ones, actually become something that is so powerful that can be always invited to for our work and for our perception of what is happening.
Yeah, I think people, I think the fear is real. Like the fear of doing the thing is real. Like getting on and making a YouTube video is scary. You know, I don't agree with be fearless. Like I think you will be afraid of, you should be afraid. Like everything great in life that was accomplished on the other side of fear. If you're not afraid at all in anything that you're doing, then your life is boring. Like you hate your life. If you're not doing anything that scares you at all. And so for me, it's feeling the fear and doing it anyway. And I use the fear of regret to then make me even more afraid of not doing it, that then I have to take the lesser fear of doing it. It's like if you have a little hangnail and like your fingernail is hurting, then somebody punches you in the arm, you don't feel the hangnail anymore, you just feel the punch to the arm. So that's maybe a little masochistic. but that's what I try to do to myself. Like the little fear that is this, I make this big fear of regret so big that then I have to go off and do it, and I don't pay attention to this little one anymore.
And, you know, I wanted just to speak a little bit about you two because, you know, you are so amazing and, you know, geniusly created this platform that really, you know, supports so many people around the world. And I know that because of what I've heard and read about you, that you want to actually touch or inspire or share the message with 1 billion entrepreneurs and empower them to do something more. So can you explain a little bit? For those who don't know you, for instance, how can you do that, or how are you doing that through your YouTube channel?
So I think everybody should have a goal that is beyond their reach. Your mission should never be accomplished. You're waking up every day and trying to empty the ocean with a spoon. You're never going to make it happen, but you're taking a spoonful out every day. I do it primarily now through YouTube and in my books. I'm not obsessed with it. Like I'll shift to the next thing if I think it could have a bigger impact. I want to help 1 billion people. People then ask me, well, how do you track it? Well, I don't, because the intention is not to track it, because I'm never done. The intention is to do something that is on a big scale. So coming on this show, my intention is, hey, I might get to meet some new people and be introduced to a new audience, and a couple more people are now on board and they hear it, right? I don't do coaching one-on-one because it's just too slow. What I want to do is hit scale. So why do I write a book? Because I can hit scale. Why do I have a YouTube channel? I think YouTube is the best way in 2018 to hit scale. And so that's why I do it. I'm picking up my Instagram because you can hit scale. Not as good as YouTube, but you can still hit some scale. And so it just filters my decision-making, that everything that I am spending my time on, when you set a big goal, you want to make sure that your actions are mapping to you accomplishing that goal. My big goal is pretty big. So is what's in my calendar helping me accomplish that goal or not? And so a lot of the things that aren't, the one-on-one coaching, that kind of stuff, doesn't, I love coaching, love helping people one-on-one, but it's too slow to help me accomplish the mission that I'm on. And so it's just a filter to help me make the best decisions for me.
And, you know, this morning, here we are in Portugal, so now it's afternoon, but this morning I've checked your YouTube channel. And again, you know, it's like on a daily basis, but 1.48 million subscribers. How do you justify that? And how do you inspire people to want to do more and want to reach more and want to tap into a better potential, a deeper potential?
So what do you mean by how do I justify? That's an interesting way of putting it.
No, I mean, it's the other way around, meaning how can you explain to people what you've reached?
You know, just a lot of work. Like, listen, go back on my channel. I sucked. Brutal, right? I was super introverted. I hated the camera. I had to have my sister come in and press record, and then leave the room because I couldn't do an interview with her, with anybody in the room with me. I'm nervous, I'm scared. Like, go back, I keep all those old videos up because it shows the journey of my career. I've had a YouTube channel for 10 years. I don't know how long I've been posting videos for, but we've done like 5,000 videos. Not all of them are public, but you better get good at something if you practice 5,000 times. My story is one of just continually working to get better at something that I was not naturally good at, and I had success, and you can too. And I still, we're making 3 videos every day on YouTube. Hopefully people can be inspired by the journey and see the growth and go back and watch how bad it was in the first videos. And my intention is really to show that anybody can do this. Maybe not do YouTube, if that's not what you want to do, but that you could get great at something having very little natural talent at it just by working hard. Yes, there's some people who can come in and just blow up because they're great at it. But if you suck at it, like I did, you can get better just through repeated practice.
Yes, and that's why I believe it's such an amazing, powerful word that should always be remembered. And for the ones that are starting, like myself, I love video and I do a lot of them and I post them on YouTube, but somehow after following, because I had the opportunity to work with you also on a group session and I learned so much, it was a game changer. Although I applied, TubeBuddy and other resources that you shared, somehow I'm not reaching the audience that I would like to. So 2 questions would be, the first one, does the location where you're at actually influences your reach? And second of all, what are the best strategies, if you could just name one? I don't want to take too much of your time on that, or maybe you want to explore, but some key strategies to actually put your content out and reach other people, knowing that you believe in your work and you really think it's valuable.
Yeah, so first off, you never reach the audience that you want to reach. Like I'm frustrated by how small my reach is, right? Like I want to be,
okay. Let's exchange.
Right? Sure, but like it never, that feeling never goes away and should never go away. Like you should always be, like that's what drives you to keep going and doing more, right? So it's a good feeling to have. That frustration will force you to put in more work and keep driving. Now, super tactical, location doesn't make a difference. For the videos. And if I had to share advice, what I always come back down to is it's on me. Like if you're a talking head, if you're a speaker, if you're a thought leader, right? If your skill set is you, right? You're sure it's not about the editing and how fancy things are put together. It's always you. Somebody sent me a message on Facebook this morning saying, Evan, I love your channel. You deserve to have 10 million subscribers. I don't. I'm not good enough. At the same time, I think I have the best channel in the history of YouTube. Like, I think I should win a Nobel Prize for my channel. But I don't deserve to have 10 million subscribers because I'm not good enough. I need to get better. My team needs to get better. Our research needs to get better. Like, everything needs to get better for me to be at 10 million. And I think that's where a lot of people fall down, is they feel like they deserve to be somewhere that they're not. And I think about once a quarter, I have this thought like, huh, what other marketing, like there has to be some other marketing strategy that I can use, like what if I posted these videos on Twitter or, this, and the hacks are always good, right? But at the end of the day, it still comes down to me, you, like it's just getting better. When I have, my camera guy, when he comes in and films me, he uses this $50,000 whatever red camera, the Dragon something gear. And he thinks like that makes all the difference. Whenever I go on vacation, I'm filming from this. And I get so pumped up that I'm filming from this because the results are the same if I'm on here or if I'm on his camera. If I'm the same, I end up being better with this because I'm fired up. Right? And he thinks like the gear makes all the difference. It doesn't matter. Now, if you are in the film business, if you are an editor, then your editing better be spot on. But if you're a talking head thought leader, what they're coming for is you. And so I come back to getting better. Like the quantity will lead to the quality. If I look at people's videos, a lot of times for thought leaders, one, they're not making enough, like daily video. You gotta make a daily video at least once a day. Like if you're a singer, a daily song. If this is what you're good at, you're an expert at, it shouldn't have to take you a full day to make a video. And if it does, then you need to get better at it so that it doesn't take you that long, right? If you're a great speaker, a great coach, and there's something on your mind, you should be able to pick up the phone and record a 10-minute video and put that up. And that should take you 12 minutes to do.
Yeah.
Daily video as a starting point. I look at the next step for thought leaders. You have great points and you're great in one-on-one sessions, or you're great in an audience view, but not great when it comes to making a video. A lot of them are too professional, too corporate, too boring. The words are good, but there's no emotional commitment behind it. You don't feel it as you're saying it. You don't feel it as you would if you're coaching somebody one-on-one. And so, like, lead with a powerful opinion. What is your powerful opinion? Like, if you do not change your mindset, you will be stuck here for the rest of your life. Like, I want a powerful, not, one of the things that I've been thinking a lot about recently is that maybe, kill all that. Like, write in, powerful opinion. And then every word that you say has to mean something to you. And I know for a lot of experts, it is coming from a place of expertise and love, but it's not expressed because there's nerves, because there's nobody in front of you. And then the last step I would say is raise the stakes. Like, it's got to be more important. You know, how do you make it more important for the person to take action? Because a lot of people will listen to it and say, yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, I agree. And they don't do anything about it. Just like when somebody comes to an event, or even a lot of coaching clients, you may not do anything about it. So how do you make it so important to them that they do something? How do you up the stakes, make it more important in the video, that they realize that if they don't change this, they don't take this kind of action, how terrible life is going to be?
Yeah, it's emotional.
Like emotional commitment to the words, but also the making it more important. Like, not just through the energy that you're giving, but through the consequences. What are the consequences for the rest of my life if I don't take this action? Not the consequence just tomorrow, but for the rest of my life. Make it bigger, make it matter. And I think thought leaders have on those three things in particular, leading with a powerful opinion, emotional commitment, and then upping the stakes, having consequences, I think people do a poor job of. And as a result, you just blend in. You know, like, there's so many people who want to be coaches and experts and speakers that the content blends in. But if there's people that, whoever you think is killing it, if it's Gary Vee or Tony Robbins or whoever you look up to, they don't blend in because they're using those points.
Wonderful. Thank you very much for the answer. You have your one word and the top 10 rules for success. Any other books on the way, or any other kind of amazing projects that you are engaged in that are still secret, but you could reveal something to us?
This is it. This is the exclusive reveal right here. So one of the things for me is I don't plan too far ahead. I think if you have a 5-year goal for yourself, you're thinking small. To think that you know what you're going to be like in 5 years, I think you're cheating yourself. And so 5 years ago, I didn't think I'd write books at all, and I've got two out now. For 18 days to 254 days, the habit will form. The average is 66 days. So what I do is I create a video series. The first, I've only done one, it's around confidence. If you want to build unstoppable confidence, watch this video. Every morning for the next 254 days, I send people a video that's 30 seconds to 5 minutes long. That's free. That helps them become more confident. And that series is doing really well, and people are resonating with it really well. And I want to expand that out to different topics, different industries, different personalities. And so I'd love to have, you know, 100 different 254s. But right now we've got the one. So that's what I'm really pumped about exploring next.
So throughout the last part of the interview, I felt that you were really, really focused on you and your team, and, you know, getting better and improving. But somehow I was thinking, are you hard on yourself and your team, or you do it from a space of pumpness and really expanding that kind of positive energy?
I think it depends on the situation. I think if you only lean on one, then you lose a lot. I think first off, when you're hard, it needs to be a kick forward, not down. It's not you suck and this is terrible, but this sucks and we need to get better. I'm never going to do anything. They kick themselves down. Where you want to use that as a kick forward to say, look at what can be accomplished. I think if I look at the people on my team, whenever they get too full of themselves, I wish Alex was here. He just took off. Alex helps me run Toronto Dance Salsa. Anytime he comes in and he's full of himself and says how great an instructor he is. And I would say, like, Alex, I would put Alex up against anybody in the world to teach beginner salsa. And I would put money on him being the best. That's how much I believe in him. But But if he comes in and he's full of himself, I say, dude, you suck. Like, where you need to go, right? And just beat him down to get better. But if he comes in and he's feeling really low, then I'll remind him of how great he is, right? And so just understanding when people need a pat on the back and encouragement, and when people need to be, you know, brought down a bit, because they're, you can only help people on their ultimate ambition. Like, Alex wants to be world class. He wants to be one of the best in the world, period, at what he does. And a lot of people on my team, I'm using his as an example. So I know what he wants to accomplish. If I know your goal, the worst thing you can do is tell me your goal. If I know what your goal is, I'm not going to let you get off the hook for not moving forward on it. Whether you're feeling low and depressed, I'm going to push you to, let's go. Come on, you said you want to do this. And rah, rah, rah. Or if you feel like, you know, I've done a lot. I'm doing really well. Like, look at me. I just got this award. Like, you suck. You know what I'm trying to do, right? Like, if I'm trying to solve, and I do this on myself too, like, I'm trying to solve the world's biggest problem, I'm never going to get it done. No matter how great I am, it's never going to happen. But I'm trying to do it every day. Then anytime, or I get recognized, or I get more of that than a negativity. It's more people saying, wow, this is so great. This is life changing. Like, thank you so much. And like, I'm nothing. I still suck compared to what I could do. So I need to be hard on myself, but in a push forward way, not a push down.
So did everybody ever told you, you know, you suck because you have almost 1.5 million, or it's just you with your kind of, you know, eagerness to continue improving?
It's honestly one of the biggest vulnerabilities, is that I don't have enough people who tell me that I suck from a loving place. Well, I can go to the comments. I'm sure there's somebody who tells me that I suck, but like, that's not what I need. Mm-hmm. So yeah, mostly through the videos. Like, when I watch an Elon Musk talking about having a backup plan for the planet, I feel like I suck. Like, I feel like I'm thinking big, this guy's thinking, and I use it in a positive way, not like I can't measure up to Elon Musk, but it makes me want to push harder on what I'm doing. And so by surrounding myself with those successes, it makes me want to push forward. So that's how I've always done it, as opposed to having somebody in my life telling me, being a physical mentor for me.
You know, maybe one of our last questions, I don't know how you are with time, but do you regret anything? I mean, there was ever something that you actually regret in life?
One of my biggest regrets, I think first off, I think regret is the most powerful force to get you to move into action. We talked about the hang nail and the punch of the arm. What led me to realize that was, I was in Paris and I was on a vacation just by myself, and this French girl comes up and asks me for directions. And I had this map open, and I'm thinking, wow, I like this girl. She's kind of cute. Maybe I should ask her out. And it didn't twig to me, like, why is this girl asking me for directions in perfect French? Didn't really twig at that point. Long story short, I was too afraid to ask her out, and I let her go, and then I regretted it. Like, what's the big, like, you know, I'm in Paris. Where am I ever going to come back here? Like, I'm never going to see this girl again. What am I so afraid of? And it bothered me so much that it was outside the Notre Dame Cathedral, which is on a river, for people aren't familiar with France. And so then she crossed the river, and like, I tried to take a picture of her. Anyway, I missed, but I put this picture up on my wall, like these ones here. I put that picture on my wall, and I looked at that every day as a reminder that I don't want to live with regret. That, like, the worst case scenario, she's going to say no. Great. And it just trained myself by looking at that picture every day that I could deal with the failure. I can't deal with not knowing. I had to know. And ever since then, I can't think of anything that I've really regretted not doing. And it's usually those things. It's not the things that you regret doing. It's what you regret not doing. Because that's become such a big, powerful filter for me. It's become ingrained ever since that day in Paris when I was 18 years old. And that's what forced me to get into the business. You know, I was 18 when that happened. And the next year, I was 19 when I had the opportunity to have 100K, do the dream job, or $300 a month doing an entrepreneurial path. I didn't want to live with regret. And so I can't think of anything in a major way that's happened ever since then, because it's such a powerful force that rules my life.
And what is like the most inspiring situation or even person that you encountered in your life?
the most inspiring person I've encountered in my life. We've got a lot on the channel. There's ones that I expect, you know, like I look at Tony Robbins and Les Brown, and you know, you expect it from them. The people who've surprised me, though, one is Denzel Washington. When we did a top 10 on Denzel Washington, because we've done so many actors, and it's been hard for us to do actors, a lot of them, it's really difficult to do a top 10 on. So I just kind of lumped him in with all the other actors. But man, Denzel Washington can bring fire when he wants to. And so I was really pleasantly surprised by that. And the other is Naveen Jain, who I'd never heard of. But he's an entrepreneur, Indian entrepreneur, who I think is in LA now or California somewhere.
He's amazing.
I've never heard of him. And he had great content. And like, man, I like this guy, Naveen Jain. Mm-hmm. And maybe a third, Priyanka Chopra, who is an Indian actress, yes, who also I had never really heard of. And again, actress, you know, a lot of the actresses have been hard to find good content. And she was really inspiring and powerful. So those three.
Any like keys of or advice keys that you would like to leave any entrepreneur with, like if you would not see that person again, like you when you were 18, and you would just like to leave a memory or something?
Yeah. Closing message. I would say make it count, like make today count. I think so often we put something off till tomorrow. I could do that tomorrow. I want to start my podcast. I could do that tomorrow. Or I could do that tomorrow. And then tomorrow never comes. You're not the same person anymore tomorrow. You've lost them. You have a moment of boldness or courageousness and then you lose it and it's gone. Tomorrow doesn't happen. So just make it count. My goal going into every day is I want to make something today that I want to show my grandkids, that I am proud to show my grandkids. So this interview, you know, I want my grandkids to see this. Hey, this is me when I was young, you know, I had still a little bit of hair, you know. That's my intention in always going in. I don't always accomplish it. You know, you can't always make every single day you get that result, but that's my intention every day. And if you did that, if you lived every day with the intention of creating work that you are proud of, you want to show your grandkids today, like today matters, even in Portugal, even though you've got like fewer hours left in the day than I do here in Toronto, like you're half an hour away from sleeping maybe, you still have time to make something that this day will count, that you want to show your grandkids. And if you took that approach, even just for the next year, every day, your life would be so unrecognizable in 1 year than what it is today, just having that little mindset shift. So if you learned anything from this show today, make the rest of today count. Like, forget about tomorrow. Today has to mean something to you.
Yes. Evan, it was an utmost pleasure to speak to you again. I just want to acknowledge the work that you do. And if someone would have had the opportunity to meet you for that 1.5 hours, well, actually it was more, and have their life changed for the better, like mine did, and the things that you just said about YouTube and about love and about friendship and about everything else, you know, if someone else can listen to this and see and put into practice what I've seen and put into practice, then I believe that you are reaching more than 1 billion. So thank you very much for your time, and you know, I hope to speak to you soon.
I appreciate it, man. Thank you for the love.
I hope you enjoyed this episode, and I would like to invite you to share the podcast with friends and family, individuals seeking more clarity about themselves and their actions. And now it's time to make it happen. See you next time.